Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. 1964, October. A woman named Mary Meyer was on her way just to get the air. She had been painting. She needed a little bit of a walk. Well, she never returned. She was murdered. The book is called Mary's Mosaic. It's by my guest, Peter Janney, and it says, the CIA conspiracy to murder John F. Kennedy and Mary Pinchot Meyer and their vision for world peace. It's published by Skyhorse Publishing. Welcome, Peter.
Great to be with you, Connie. Thank you for having me.
My pleasure. Unfortunately, I wish it could have been a happy book, but it's an engrossing book about how conspiracies can go from generation to generation.
That's right. And, you know, as we're coming into the 50th anniversary of the assassination of President Kennedy, this is still a time where, even after 50 years, we're attempting to uncover the full truth of actually what took place, not only in President Kennedy's assassination, but in Mary Meyer's a year later.
Yeah.
So here we are, still struggling with the truth, and hopefully, maybe even today, we can uncover it a little bit more.
All right, let's start with you. Father Wister?
Wister.
Wister Janney.
Correct.
Yale, with the boys, ends up, after the war, CIA.
Yes. And that kind of trajectory he wasn't the first person to go in that direction.
Yeah.
I think a lot of men coming out of World War II who had seen a lot of combat were really quite moved to possibly promote move their lives on a career trajectory where there would be a minimal chance for a World War III, given the nuclear age that we had just entered. So the CIA attracted a lot of idealistic young men.
Also, because I have to tell you, my father had been a lieutenant commander of the Navy, and after the war, donating his uniform, somebody said to him, don't donate it, we're going to have another war with Russia.
Right.
So was that theme that was running through the country at the time.
Yes.
You are one of two sons there. Mary Pinchot Meyer had been a beauty, good family. She had even at prep school met Jack Kennedy, and he had a bit of a crush on her, but she really liked Cord.
That's right. Coming out of World War II, Cord Meyer and Jack Kennedy were sort of two emerging young stars who were sort of destined in some way, shape, or form to take a leading position within their generation. And I think for Mary, initially, when Cord Meyer came back from World War II,
he had lost an eye.
He'd been wounded, and he was convinced that the province of war just had no place on this planet, and he wanted to do whatever he could to make sure that there could be a structure on the planet that would help prevent the possibility of another war.
Which was the United Nations, that never quite got the strength or the backbone that it should have had.
That's right.
Jack, of course, comes back and is a writer for newspapers, and he does a book. What is it?
Profiles and Courage.
Yeah.
Yes.
Whether he totally wrote it or whether Ted Sorensen or Arthur Schlesinger did a little help, we don't know. But it doesn't matter. He does go on, and Mary marries Cord.
Correct.
Cord at that point has not joined the CIA. But once he did, he changed.
That's right. You know, for several years after 1945, Cord really gave his heart and soul to something called the United World Federalists, who were trying to use the UN or another structure to be the peacekeeper of the world. And after 2-3 exhausting years of trying to make that happen, it was clear that it wasn't going to happen.
Yeah.
And I think that really sent Cord into a place of despondency. And it was at that point that he moved into the CIA, although that was not his first choice. He would have liked to have had an academic appointment, which he was fully qualified to have, but that didn't materialize.
But when he got to the CIA, it was like a change of personality, and Mary was married to this new man. They have three sons. And the middle son, Michael, is your dearest friend.
That's correct. Yes. And when we were 9 years old, which would be in 1956, Michael was accidentally hit by a car at dusk one evening and killed.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a huge loss for everyone who knew him, for the family, and of course me. It was my first event in my own life that had to do with death and the confrontation of death.
Yeah. Mary is devastated. You go off to school, you go off to college. Was it her death that brought you back?
Well, it was, yes, it was her death, but it was the circumstances around her death that brought me back, because at the trial of the person that they were trying to frame for the murder, which took place in July of 1965, Ray Crump Jr., he was acquitted. There was ultimately, there wasn't a shred of forensic evidence linking Ray Crump to the body of Mary Meyer or the crime scene. And Mr. Crump had just an incredible African-American attorney Dovey Roundtree defending him, who was convinced that Crump was being framed, and she essentially staked her professional reputation on this case.
To set the scene, we also have to say that Mary's sister was married to Ben Bradley. It is a whole very upscale group of people in Washington, and they protect their own.
Yes. And it's a very unique elite group, and there's a lot of secrecy that occurs around Mary's death, because it's only a handful of people who actually knew that she was having an affair with President Kennedy and keeping a diary about what was taking place in that affair.
And that was sort of a whole other side of Jack Kennedy. It was maybe the best side of him, because Mary sort of was the idealist in a world of non-idealists. Yeah.
Well, President Kennedy came into the presidency as a cold warrior. I think he left a changed man, in the sense that after the Cuban Missile Crisis, he really turned his attention to world peace. And in that pursuit, he had a real ally in Mary Meyer. She was a pacifist from the word go, and she kept, I think, helping him understand what was at stake at this particular point in history.
Interesting, too, is that the godfather to her sons was Angleton.
James Jesus Angleton, yes.
Right. The head of, what is it, the black parts of the CIA.
Covert operations,
And I do want to hold up the picture of Mary at Jack's 46th birthday, and on the other side, the one picture of them together with her mother.
That's correct. That was taken in the fall of 1963, September 24th, September 1963.
Yeah.
And of course, 2 months later, he would be dead.
Mm-hmm. Now, who did it? Who did it to Jack? Was it the CIA?
In my opinion, given all the research that has done by a very committed group of citizens, not our government, but a very committed group of private citizens, I think the last 49 years have consistently started to reveal that the Central Intelligence Agency orchestrated the assassination of President John Kennedy.
Mm-hmm. And the role of Lyndon Baines Johnson, who was going to be dumped from the ticket because of his involvement with Bobby Baker. And Baker had been on the cover of Life magazine the week before, dressed up at a costume party. And evidently he was the one who was the, well, the fixer of dates and people for his group.
That's right. And I maintain, as do a number of other very accomplished researchers, that Lyndon Johnson was part of the plan to get rid of Kennedy, as was FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover.
Mm-hmm.
This plan had a lot of support within the highest levels of government.
Yeah. At one point, nobody has ever mentioned it, but Lee Harvey Oswald had been interested in football, and he had even tried out, I remember, it was like one line in the New Yorker, an article about, I said, wait a minute, if he was trying out for the football, the team, Bobby Baker was involved too with that team.
I wasn't aware of that. That's a fascinating detail.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sorry I didn't keep it, but it's one of those things. Oh, yes, I remember. Yeah. So there is Kennedy, who was assassinated. Mary has been keeping a diary.
Yes.
And she also, I will say, was friendly with Timothy Leary.
Yes.
And had certain narcotics or drugs that she could, we don't know for sure, but that she did experiment with Kennedy.
Well, we have to remember that in the late 1950s, the artistic avant-garde was very interested in hallucinogens, things like psilocybin, LSD, that kind of thing. And there was even, you know, a group here in Hollywood who were very mm-hmm. committed explorers of this kind of experience, Cary Grant being one of them. There were a
yeah.
number of others, Andre Previn. And so Mary, who was a seeker of sorts, I think, got wind of this, and she wanted to try it, which she did. This mm-hmm. took place in the late 1950s. And as she became more experienced, she realized, as did a number of other people, the potential of what the hallucinogenic experience
yeah.
could give people.
All right, now he has been killed. She has been mourning and keeping and getting stirred up more and more to, there's been the Warren Report. Nothing has quite satisfied her need to know. And she's made it clear. She is divorced from Cord, but she still has connections there. Goes for this walk, and whether she was watched, whether she was pointed, she does not return.
Correct.
Who gets the blame?
Well, from my research and what I write in the book, I think it's pretty clear that the CIA was behind her death as well. And the reason is this. When the Warren Commission report came out in September of 1964, Mary bought the paperback copy. She'd already been researching for nearly a year what really had mm-hmm. taken place in Dallas, and I think had put together a lot of pieces,
yeah.
pieces that I maintain sort of form a mosaic of really what had taken place. And she was just incensed that there was a second cover-up going on within our culture, within our country,
mm-hmm.
to cover the assassination up, to make it look like there had just been one lone nut assassin, Lee Harvey
yeah.
Oswald, who had done the deed, when in fact he was, as he told